Good morning once again. Welcome to Rush Hour, but this is the big issue. Now, are you a student, educator, or any other stakeholder? We are hosting the first ever. We are bringing to you now. This is Vision. New Vision is bringing to you the first ever Education Expo under the theme "Where Education and the World of Employment Meet." From the 27th to the 29th of January at the Uganda Institute of Information and Communications Technology grounds in Nakawa, next to MUBS. Come and enjoy numerous exhibitions, workshops, mentorship talks, and more. Tickets will only be available at 10,000 Uganda shillings. Only 10,000 Uganda shillings, and this will be at the entrance. For inquiries, contact 0787 511106. I repeat, for inquiries, contact 0787 511106. The expo is sponsored by the Uganda Institute of Information and Communications Technology and Stanbic Bank. Now, you're in time for the big issue. Go to our social media platforms at Urban TV Uganda on Twitter, Urban Television on Facebook, and join us as we analyze headlining stories of the week. And with me this morning, gentlemen, John Odek. They all have some most of them are journalists. We have one who was a journalist and left. So, yeah. We have John Odek, a journalist covering energy, the energy sector. We have Charles Kazoba, a researcher, former journalist as well, and Wanyama Wanga, a journalist. Gentlemen, I'm very pleased to have you once again. Right, but let's start off. This week has been very interesting, especially in Parliament. We saw that the lands minister passed his Namuganza, snubbed the committee that was established to probe allegations against her. And, you know, she was said to be censured. I don't know how that is going to go. As if that was not enough, on Wednesday, the Speaker of the House told Joel Senyonyi's COSASE, the one he heads, that it is underperforming, and she has called for an audit into it. Also, Senyonyi went to social media. Moving from Parliament to social media is also another issue. We will delve into those issues, but for now, I want to pick their minds. Really, what are the headlining stories for them? I'll start with you.
Yeah, thank you.
What made headlines for you this week?
Well, there are many headlines, but I think what stands out, as you have pointed out, is what's of concern is for me is the NSSF.
Okay.
Yeah. The NSSF has been in the media since the end of last year about the reappointment of the MD and his deputy. Of course, we got the deputy appointed and the MD wasn't reappointed.
Yes, yes.
They said that process is still ongoing. But then we have seen lots of leakages in the media.
Yeah.
Letters from the minister, letters from other people. There are some disturbing things. And for me, one of the disturbing things has actually not been brought to the... It's in the public eye, but it's not being questioned. There are reports which have not been denied by anyone that the body has actually been meeting in Kapeka, somewhere under the chairmanship of a retired general. So these are issues which are disturbing.
Absolutely.
NSSF has a structure. It has got a management. It has got a board. It has got two supervising ministries. I think the next level after that is the president. Why decision-making should be anywhere outside those structures cannot be explained.
Absolutely.
And has to be explained.
Absolutely.
I think that is one of the things which Parliament say they are setting up a probe. Those are some of the things which they should put the board chairperson of NSSF to task.
Absolutely. Kazoba, Charles.
Yes, I would also wish to add that briefly. When I read the minister's letter to about NSSF, I was very, very perturbed. And I was wondering, this Richard Byarugaba, is he the most powerful Ugandan we have now? Because you see the minister bothering to complain that Richard Byarugaba has defied three cabinet ministers. And he had also ignored the presidential directive. And then you also see somewhere the National Chief Coordinator of Operation Earth Creation, General Saleh, also lamenting about the same guy. So I was like, if it is true, there are standing allegations of corruption, why can't it be prosecuted right away, other than try to labor, explain that this man has totally defied government directives.
Is that what made headlines for you as well?
Yeah, it did. But also, there's something that came up. This issue of extortion at Entebbe Airport.
Ah, yeah.
It is, we've had a problem with the tourism industry for the last 3 years because of Corona, then Ebola. Now these reports coming in, they keep affecting the industry. Mm. I don't know why they're not taking this very, very seriously, but it is a big issue. And as a country, we need to make some money out of tourism.
Absolutely. Yeah. John.
I think the same as my colleagues have said, but maybe I would just add that the budget making process is on.
Mm-hmm.
And I just realized last evening that in June the budget has to be read. So sometimes time moves so fast. And when we've been seeing how the budgets are being discussed, there's a lot of budget cuts. It was quite surprising to me that this operation Shuja in the DRC has got even no funding.
Mm-hmm.
So, and so many ministries are suffering from budget cuts. So leave alone the issue is where are we getting the funds to, you know, to fund the various activities. It's quite perplexing.
Right. Now, actually, that is one of the headlining stories, because throughout the week, we saw that there were huge budget cuts to very key sectors, even tourism itself. And so we wait to see how that will go. But away from that, today's order paper, my order paper today, has about two to three issues. Now, but let's start with this one. Speaker Anita Mong ordered a value for money audit on the committee of statutory authorities and state enterprises because of underperformance. Let's take a look at this story, then we'll turn with so much more.
The Minister of State for Housing, Persis Namuganza, has snubbed last summons to the select committee, which was appointed by Parliament to scrutinize the censure motion.
Honourable Minister has again failed to show up in the committee. We waited for over 1 hour and a half. There was no communication. We tried to contact our lawyers. The lawyers said they are not aware or they have not been given instructions by the Honourable Minister to come and represent her.
Namuganza, who was expected to defend herself on accusations of misconduct and other ingredients in the censure motion, has skipped committee summons for the third time.
So the committee has decided to proceed ex parte. This means we are going to proceed without her input in this investigation.
The chairperson, Mwine Mpaka, noted that they have decided to proceed ex parte without listening to the minister's side of the story, since she has turned down her right to fair hearing.
Her absence doesn't have legal implications. However, she's forfeiting her right to defend herself. But in this particular matter, her absence doesn't have any legal implications.
The seven-member committee has now embarked on a retreat to evaluate the evidence available to establish whether there is a prima facie case against the minister. They expect to have a report finished this week and hand it over to the Speaker of Parliament on Friday this week.
The rules of procedure give us 15 days, and these 15 days elapse this Friday. So by this Friday, we should have handed over this report to the Speaker.
On Friday, the minister delegated her lawyer, Norman Pandey, who was sent away by the committee for lack of clear instructions from her.
Of all places, you appear before Parliament to be an imposter, to represent somebody in the cameras.
The committee has 14 days to determine a prima facie case against Namuganza, which expires on January 23rd. Story by Fred Kajiwi for the news.
That is what transpired in Parliament this week, actually, away from the same issue. We'll come back to it. But now, gentlemen, Namuganza has been making news since last year up to now. And we realized that this week they were sitting for, I think, the last time in regard to her censure motion. John, you cover Parliament, I understand, and first give us a little bit brief. Why does she keep snubbing? And with this last meet of the committee, where is it headed?
Thank you very much, Lynn. I was, had the opportunity to sit through all those sittings.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, they were limited by time, but I think she's using a technicality, saying that she had filed a case in the Constitutional Court against Parliament.
Mm.
So she was using that as a way not to appear. So she requested or demanded that she gets a written explanation from Parliament as to whether that committee should proceed, given that she had a case in court. But I think the Speaker had clarified earlier on, you know, she went to court and lost. The Speaker clarified that the processes were already on. And even in the court case, I think court told her that she should not use court to fight her battle in a sense. So she should not try to use court to block normal parliamentary proceedings.
Mm-hmm.
So she's in that kind of fix. She has really, refused to show up. Well, she says that she fears she will not be heard, but she sent a lawyer, and you saw the lawyer also how he was talking.
Mm-hmm. Charles, I'm very curious. What do you make of Namuganza's unshaken move or unbothered move since from the word go? She's not bothered. She seems to stand by her word and against I don't know how many members of parliament, and now a censure motion.
First of all, my stand has always been very clear. The censure of Honorable Persis Namuganza shouldn't have had issues to do with her language against Parliament. It should have been substantial grounds. There should be a real justification of why she should be censured. And if they had pursued the issues regarding her falsification of presidential directive on the Naguru Nakawa land, that would have swayed the public. But then this censure seems to be much more personal. The public has failed to buy it. Now, regarding her latest snub of the committee, Honorable Namuganza has consistently said that she failed a case against Parliament.
Mm.
And I think she brought notice to the Attorney General, who represents Parliament. But you realize we are going into the same scenario like previously under Right Honorable Rebecca Kadaga, failing to acknowledge separation of powers.
Mm-hmm.
That Parliament keeps on with business or decisions in total disregard of what is happening in the courts of law. So may I buy her argument? Why can't we also understand that if she has a case in court, then this process can be suspended? What is the rush?
But there are two. You already alluded to the fact of separation of powers.
Yes.
The judiciary is independent from parliament.
Exactly. Under the principle of separation of
powers.
Yes.
So they can both go.
You do not act totally independent of the other.
Mm.
No, you work together.
Actually, maybe Charles, if I can clarify very quickly. You know, when she went to court, the whole process was delayed until court ruled.
Mm.
There were already proceedings against her. Mm. The investigations were ongoing.
Yes, yes.
So when you remember, she has two reports against her. The first one was on the Naguru, Nakawa, where the committee recommended that she should be held accountable for giving land to fake investors without a presidential directive.
So then the one for misconduct.
So after that first report, she rushed to court And Parliament had to wait for that process to be completed. And the court ruled against her.
So they moved on with...
They moved on with the process. Now, when the other processes were ongoing,
yes,
she again ran to court. And this is what court doesn't like. When there's parliamentary activity ongoing, people have tried it before. We try to use court to block it. So court say we are not here to be used for your, you know, political interests.
Very, very interesting. I come to you, Wanyama Wanga. We have seen over the years, we've seen censures of ministers, of members of parliament.
Yes.
And do you think Namuganza's censure is going to see the light of day?
You know, the problem with censure, it's not like in court. In court, you either have a case or not.
True.
Censure is a political process. It's a numbers game. And that's why you see Namuganza running up and down. One, her censure is flimsy.
Yes.
If you look at the substantive, what would have been the substantive case of the Naguru land, it's actually flimsy. This other censure, this other thing of her conduct before of undermining parliament, whatever, that's not something which you can censure a minister about. But you see, in censure, once somebody raises a signature, once they raise signatures against you, you know that you're on a losing end.
True.
And she knows that. That's why she doesn't even bother to appear before the committee. Because that committee is not going to, her appearance is not going to change anything. The leadership in parliament has already made up its minds that they want to censure Namuganza. And that committee's report is will go the way they want it. And the vote in the parliament will go the way they want it. So that's why Namuganza even doesn't bother to attend.
She was saying over the weekend that she left everything to God.
It's a question of numbers. It's not like
it's
a
already,
judge is going to come
they're
up
already
with,
against her.
They're already against her.
Mm-hmm.
So she tried to use the court process to delay it, but still it doesn't.
But I don't know. Is it fair, really, for... Because she seems to be standing alone. No one is even on her side. Is it fair for her? Charles, what do you make of that?
I think what is affecting her is her previous record.
Yes. She's always been on the spot.
Yes, they see her as a very arrogant legislator who feels she's too powerful. So that's why everybody is gunning against her, although there are no issues really. And me, I still feel arrogance should not be an issue.
Yeah.
And then I think also this demonstrates that the leadership in parliament, and that's the speaker and the deputy, have taken whole control of the parliament. Ideally, in a censure motion, the one person who is supposed to be impartial and seen to be impartial is the speaker.
Yes.
Which is not the case this time. And once that impartiality is not there, it becomes very difficult for things to proceed. And that's why you see Namuganza is not turning up. Because however much the speaker is from a certain political divide or what, the speaker is supposed to be impartial and be seen to be impartial on all matters. On all matters, especially essential.
Absolutely. John, the issue of, he brings out the issue of leadership at Parliament, and it has been in the spotlight for a bit because there are always pointing fingers at the leadership in Parliament. They're calling it some sort of bickering. First of all, we saw Zake, you know, in and out. We saw other members of parliament also having some issues here and there. Then Namuganza, now the current one, John Senyonyi. Ujoa Senyonyi, what's happening? Do you think the leadership at parliament has a problem?
I think as a leader, you'll always face up with the so-called bad boys and the bad girls. So on the one hand, I think that the two speakers have really gone through the storm. It has not been easy for them. Okay, they were not there by some kind of organized, I think they were there by following the death of Olanya. It was not all planned, that's one. Two, also they are facing people with difficult characters. So I think, as you said, perhaps as leaders there, they need to be a little bit more outstanding in character.
Okay.
But first of all, coming on Namuganza's side alone, I think she needs to improve her social skills. Basically, she has a problem with social skills, I think. Communication. Remember, in the previous parliament, she had a long battle with the speaker,
yes.
Rebecca Kadaga. Mm. There are even reports that in the ministry, she has similar challenges with the staff. I watched one scenario where she was in the field and she was having those kind of exchanges with the those land guys, you mm-hmm. know, people in land dispute who accused her of already making her mind, and it was useless for them to attend meetings with her, and she also had that exchange. So I think she needs to up her political skills, social and leadership skills.
Yes.
But I think the biggest mistake she's making is to try to take on the leadership. I mean, she alleged that the deputy speaker is raping the constitution using such extreme terms. She has attacked the marriage of the speaker. Really, that puts them, the two, at very difficult, positions.
Absolutely.
And from the corridors of parliament, because I try to hear what the MPs are saying, many are not happy with her conduct per se. They are
her
not against her
personal conduct.
And again, the oath of office, the rules of procedure, code of conduct, what we are saying, what we may say don't look like serious issues. In the oath of office for a minister, it stated that you're supposed to advise the president. You take an oath to use your best ability to advise the president. In case here there's land issue of corruption, don't give land to... Okay, if there are the so-called forged presidential directive, if it was, let's say it was there, now the land was given to who? The investors are not seen. Remember, mm-hmm. the investors wrote saying that we didn't even ask for this land.
Right.
So then the other thing about going out to blackmail and abuse parliament, I think that's not good enough.
All right, gentlemen, we need to take a break. When we return, I want us to look at where the leadership of this parliament is headed. No, particularly the 11th parliament. The members of the public have pointed fingers at the 11th Parliament and its performance. Already we're seeing the Speaker poking holes in one of the committees and saying you're underperforming. So perhaps it reflects on the leadership as well. Let's take a break. When we return, we'll look at that and so much more.
with student, educator, or any other stakeholder, mark your calendars for the first ever New Vision Education Expo under the theme Where Education and the World of Employment Meet from 27th to 29th January 2023 at the Uganda Institute of Information and Communications Technology Grounds in Nakawa next to MUBS. The one-stop center for all things education will feature various exhibitions, workshops, mentorship talks, and so much more. Don't miss the chance to connect with numerous industry experts and explore numerous exciting opportunities in the education sector. Tickets will be available at the entrance for only 10,000 shillings. For inquiries, contact 0787-511-106. The Education Expo is sponsored by New Vision, Vision Publishing, Uganda Institute of Information and Communications Technology, and Stanbic Bank. ABBA.
Welcome back from that break. You're watching The Big Issue here on Urban TV. My name is Lynn Komjisha. With me is Wanyama Wanga. We have Charles Kazoba and John Odiek. We're trying to understand the events of the week and, you know, look at how, you know, they happened and what they mean for us, as especially in the media, but also you in the public. We saw that on Wednesday, Speaker Nita Mong ordered a value for money audit on the Committee of Statutory Authorities and State Enterprises because of underperformance. Now, that committee is headed by Nakawa East Member of Parliament, and that is Joel Senyonyi of the National Unity Platform. Gentlemen, before we can delve into the leadership issues that we have with our 11th Parliament, first of all, John, still I want to start with you because you are at Parliament. Is Constancy actually underperforming? Because we've been seeing how many reports. We saw airlines, we saw UNRWA, we saw there was another one. Is it really underperforming?
Yeah, that is quite true. There are over 100 entities in the government. Mm. But they have concentrated on just a handful.
Okay.
And spent so much time on those, you know, Uganda Airlines. Too much time spent on them. I think maybe Senyonyi still lacks the experience to do that kind of difficult task. I think I would sympathize with him.
Mm.
He was given a very huge responsibility. Mm-hmm. I think that responsibility, I wouldn't say if he was in the second term of parliament, or he needed to be more senior. Maybe if he was an experienced civil servant, an experienced politician way before, he could handle. So I definitely, 4 out of 100 is really small.
Mm.
And also there are other circumstances that were prevailing. Remember, we had this COVID,
yeah,
Ebola lately, and other challenges, the death of the speaker.
Mm.
Then I think also he has had problem balancing parliament and the party. So many things ongoing.
Mm-hmm.
But he definitely, I think he should have prioritized
committee work.
Stop being in the media too much. We would like to be him to be here.
Charles, we saw that after that drama in parliament, Senyonyi went to social media and attacked the speaker. You said you headed you were part of the Kosasi previously, and what did you do? And lots of other things. Is this really right for them to take these matters to our social media?
Our current parliament is more or less like a market.
Mm.
You do not see them give guidance to a country that is at crossroads, a country that has so many challenges to deal with.
Sure.
So this one shouts at the other, the speaker also responds in her own way. It's more or less like a market. But overall, the speaker's decision to attack a chair of a committee in her own house, I felt it was overboard. This is an administrative issue.
Mm-hmm.
They could have handled these issues even
privately
within the commission.
Mm-hmm.
To raise issues of incompetence which also fall on her, by the way.
True.
And that's why Senyon is alluding to it, mm-hmm. that, look, my friend, even if you accuse me of incompetence, we can also say the same of you when you are in the same committee.
Mm.
But why at this time? You know, when I saw the picture of the Uganda Airlines CEO with the speaker, it raised a lot of issues, especially in the middle of investigations by COSASE.
Mm-hmm.
I knew something would be coming against Senyon. Me, myself, I felt Senyon went overboard by damaging the image of the country when he attacked Uganda Airlines in public.
And was also accused of leaking the
yes.
details
so
of that.
So it showed some kind of conflict of interest.
Mm-hmm.
I failed to understand what his intentions were.
Mm-hmm.
The speaker is raising issues. Yes, we can agree that the committee is not performing to its best,
mm-hmm.
and the resources are being wasted.
Mm-hmm.
However, when you go to the public, the public sees Senyon as a hero.
Oh.
Yes. Despite these issues seriously being raised against Senyon, because they looked at the investigations on the railway,
mm-hmm.
and then the Uganda Airlines,
yeah, no, Uganda Airlines,
and then UNRWA.
Yes.
So they see him as a hero. They say the man has done a thorough job, even though he has not performed to the expectations of Parliament.
Right.
So in future.
Mm.
The speaker should reprimand these people, not within
sure.
It's an administrative issue. She can deal with those issues in her office.
Absolutely, Wanga. And I know you've been in this in journalism for a while, and you've seen what happens with our parliaments. Question is, have we seen this before? Have committees previously been put on the spot for underperformance? What have they done, and how did we move back to the 11th Parliament?
I think this the attack on the performance of COSASE by the speaker is shocking.
Mm-hmm.
One, a committee of parliament is not independent. It's only working on behalf of Parliament.
Mm.
Parliament can actually choose to recall that work from the committee and do it itself. Now, the committee chair has got a boss who is actually the leader of opposition, because the accountability committees report to the leader of opposition.
True.
If the speaker had issues with a committee, the best thing should have been to call the leader of opposition and lay down the facts.
Mm-hmm.
Say, this committee has only done 4 reports out of 170, but you would have to lay that in comparison with, for example, I need to see, as an outsider, I need to see the performance of this committee vis-a-vis the committee of the previous parliament, vis-a-vis the committee
of the other parliament. Mm-hmm.
They might have done 4, but that might be the norm. So we need to see the disparities. But beyond that, these are things, like you said, which can be handled administratively.
Mm.
Call the committee chair, call the leader of opposition before the parliamentary commission, or even in the speaker's office, and discuss their performance.
Mm-hmm.
What we are seeing from this parliament is there are a lot of side shows running to the media, and not attending to the issues which affect the ordinary people in this country.
Right.
These are matters which should be solved administratively. A committee of parliament has got the mandate of parliament. Basically, the speaker is actually attacking her own self,
mm-hmm.
because this committee is delegated, has got actually delegated authority. It is like an MD of a company.
Wanyama, just a quick information, then I'll let you continue.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, for me, I'm very happy that these things are coming out in the open.
Why?
It would have troubled us journalists to start going behind.
To investigate.
To investigate.
No, but you see,
now citizens are being involved. That is
no,
very
what
good
is happening is like an MD of a company attacking his marketing manager or his head of audit for not working. It doesn't, you cannot.
It looks bad on them.
It looks bad.
Yes. Mm. So, and I did ask you, the, I think the part of the question that you've not answered, how was it previously? Have we seen this kind of behavior, you know, happen in previous parliaments?
No, we've not seen the speaker and clash with the committee chairpersons to this level.
Mm-hmm.
It has not happened before.
No, there have been few cases where reports have been withdrawn from chairpersons. I give you one. There was one about the Kampala City Abattoir,
mm-hmm.
where it's alleged the chairperson received money. It was about the land here and the city abattoir. Some issue about compensation and government was trying to take it over.
Mm.
Then some allegations of bribery, so that the report does not reflect the reality. It has happened.
Mm-hmm.
A few reports, but some of these people have not paid attention because it has not come in the public.
In the public.
What is the common? What is the common with?
Rising, I think it's in regard to incompetence.
What is the common in committees is the disagreement within the committee.
Yes, yes, that
because
is common.
Because the committees have basically two sides.
Mm.
Even the COSASE, even though it is an accountability committee headed by the opposition, has got members of NRM on
yes.
it. So usually they disagree during report submission.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when you see a majority report and a minority
yes,
report.
Yes, yes.
We have actually had sessions, not just once, more than once, I think Odiek can explain to us, when the House has adopted the minority report from the committee, yes, and rejected the majority report.
Yes.
Yeah, those things happen. And that, the structure for that.
Absolutely. Charles,
maybe Charles, remember some of the weakness we see in these committees today. Remember, Charles, we used to go to Parliament at 8,
yeah,
up to 1, then we come back 2 to 4. But now these committees are starting at 10, 11, and soon they are making interviews in the corridors. That diligence has been lost.
I like that you're ushering us still back to our 11th parliament and how it looks. Mm.
Let me just put in something here, which I'm seeing probably lacking in this parliament.
Uh-huh.
Because I observe many parliaments, the one in the UK, the one in the US, the one in Kenya, is the issues of seniority.
Okay.
Usually, parliaments have almost an unwritten rule of respecting seniority. I remember when Hillary Clinton was elected senator for New York, she had been a first lady for many years. She was accomplished, but she went into that Senate as the junior senator for New York. And they said, as a junior senator, she cannot even head a committee.
Mm.
Yeah, but in our parliament, we are seeing now, for example, Senyonyi, not to judge him,
mm-hmm.
but he's a first-term MP heading
yes.
a committee.
Which John
that,
has
That
has
would
a
not happen in many parliaments.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, Charles.
In regard to Honorable Senyonyi's investigations, what I would have wanted to come out is the way he conducted the investigations. Did he have a hidden agenda? Was there a conflict of interest? Other than focusing general on the performance of committee, that you should have done so many reports in a very short time, we could have focused ourselves on the investigations. Was it a thorough job? And what are the results? So that we don't get lost in the many. I was in Parliament for quite some time, but I know those these accountability committees have not been performing to the expectations.
Mm.
Even under Honorable Nandala Mafabi, you'd see that there was always backlog, always. So the if the speaker, the current speaker, is raising this issue, then the commission should sit down and establish the problem, because the commission has the prime minister, has the two speakers, has the leader of opposition, and the members of the opposition.
Mm-hmm.
So they could sit down and look at the problem in general terms, and not just focusing on this parliament alone.
Absolutely. John, coming back to Parliament, with all the issues that so far we have discussed, they all point again at the leadership of Parliament. And I want us to, of course, as we conclude, start to conclude on the conversation, I want us to end with that. What do we make of the 11th Parliament? You cover it. You have been there, Charles. And Wanga, you have been there as well. What do you make of the 11th Parliament? I'll start with you, John.
I think there's a big change in the Parliament leadership. Remember that continuing from the late Speaker Olanya was ended abruptly.
Yeah.
So we have a completely new generation of leaders.
Mm.
And I think this is expected. For me, I will still credit them for doing their best. The circumstances have not been easy. The economy is down. This Ukraine war.
Mm.
Things are just tough, not just for the Parliament, but for literally everyone. So they have had their good side and the downside. That's what I can say. But there's a lot of hope in these people. The other thing also, Lynn, maybe from a gender perspective, it's a lady heading the Parliament, and the Prime Minister is also a lady. The gender minister is a lady. So for the first time, we are seeing women, Namuganza is a lady. It's women now in the forefront.
Well, very interesting that you mentioned that. But I still, my problem right now is the issue of leadership. There seem to be an issue. Charles, what do you make of it?
My colleague here, John, seems to be very soft.
I know.
The speaker will not do anything to
No,
me.
No, I'm not.
The truth is, there are challenges regarding our leadership in Parliament.
Mm.
And the two speakers should work on that seriously. We have senior people who have left Parliament and they can be consulted. Kadaga is still around. I think Anita should find time and talk to her. Second is around. I don't see why they should think that now, since they're in the driver's seat, then that is it. They should be able to talk to people who have been there. Otherwise, they are taking this country for granted, and it's costing us heavily. Some of these processes are not necessary. Taxpayers' money are getting wasted, and therefore it's not good.
Right.
It's not good.
Wanga, compared to previous parliaments, John here says we have a new breed of leaders. It's a new breed of leaders, and I don't know if that means that you should handle parliament business differently.
No, I think what this parliament is failing to do, just the leadership.
Mm.
The first elected speaker under this, what I would call the post-1996 constitution, was Francis Wapahavudo.
Yes, yes.
An eminent gentleman.
Yes.
Then we had Francis Ayume.
Mm-hmm.
Then we had Edward Sekandi.
Mm-hmm.
Those three guys were sober fellows. Then we had, of course, Rebecca Kadaga, who managed that parliament for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Now, these people are failing to meet, to hit the bar. And those of us who have been around, we are judging them against that group.
Mm.
Secondly, was a quiet man. He had his disagreements with the people. You would never see it in public.
Mm.
He had serious disagreements with people in parliament, but it would never spill over into the public.
Mm.
What we are seeing here is personal conflicts within parliament spilling over into public. I think they should just look at how Francis Ayume, Wapa, Sekandi handled the previous parliaments.
Mm.
That will help them a lot.
And pick a leaf.
They should pick a leaf from those three gentlemen. And of course, Kadaga, who is still around.
Kadaga had her own challenges.
Yes, Kadaga actually was more combative than the other three.
Yes.
The other three were very sober.
Very interesting. Okay, so moving forward as we wind up, John, do you think we're going to see everyone is pointing a finger at it. Do you think they're going to reach a point and maybe change a little bit?
In the parliament?
Mm.
I think that, by the way, all is not lost for Senyoni. You see, every time people make mistakes, the best thing is for him to to learn from that mistake and grow. There's nobody who achieved without a lot of...
Even the leadership.
The leadership parliament.
Mm.
If they can learn from these challenges and hear what the public is saying, there's a huge opportunity. But if these mistakes are not made, I don't think that, they are always ups and downs. So this down should bring them up. That's the way I see it.
Mm.
Actually, if I had a chance of meeting Senyoni, I would tell him that, please calm down, hear what they are saying. By the way, those reports he has not produced has affected the budget process completely. So much that some of those reports have been passed omnibus as yesterday without even the parliament going through them. Even I had some of the MPs in the members of the committee saying that they have really lost it. They have lost confidence in the Senyoni. And one time, Alice Alasso said that, you know, a character of a committee is determined by the character of the chairperson. If you have a good chairperson, the committee succeeds. But if the chairperson is bogged by media attention or some bribes, Alasso herself said that people used to bring 100 million, 200 million, but she had pasted on the back of our wall that something about the Bible, which is against corruption. So whenever those civil servants would bring big envelopes, she would just point here.
Mm.
So Senyoni just needs to style up.
Okay. Charles, in a minute, moving forward.
Yes, I would, although it is partisan, it's not good, but I would recommend that the two speakers ask for a retreat with the SEC members. These are very senior people who have been around, so that they can engage on how they are moving. Well, they seem to be moving away from our national agenda, and they are focusing on petty issues, petty issues. You hear Deputy Speaker having an outburst against a minister. These things are not really good for a country.
Absolutely. Wanga, in a minute. Moving forward.
Yeah, I think Parliament should stop these probes of a committee to probe this, a committee to probe that. These are just avenues of them earning allowances. And the expenditure in that Parliament is just way out of hand.
True.
They should just focus on serious legislation. There are many things affecting the people.
Mm.
People want, the people are expecting actually resolutions on school fees, resolutions on this. They are not. That they are just busy investigating each other.
Mm.
How can you have a committee to investigate another committee in parliament? That's an hurdle.
Absolutely.
Even the IGG is investigating NSSF and other investigations.
But IGG is also investigating Joel Senyoni.
So.
Very interesting. So, people who've been watching, thank you very much for making time to, you know, catch what we have been looking at as the events of the week. Gentlemen, I thank you very much for your time. And you stick around, because we are coming back in the Rush Talk with our parents playing their roles. Are they actually playing their roles? Because we're seeing a lot going wrong with our children in this day and age. We need to understand. Do we need to go back to the drawing board? Should Parliament also go back to the drawing board, like Charles is suggesting, and maybe perhaps redirect its agenda? Stay around. Do not go anywhere. Miles is coming back with the Rush Talk, and I wish you a very good morning and a lovely weekend.